special day that the whole nation comes together to at least give thanks. I don't know if they give thanks to the right person or to God, but they do recognize that day. Whether they spend it in the right way or not, that's up to them. But I do want to make a couple of announcements. We've got several that are in your bulletin that I need to remind you of. One of those is tonight we will not have our regular Sunday night service here at Mountain Springs. We'll be at Sandy Ridge. Now, I know we've got a meal immediately after the morning worship time, and I hope you're planning to stay. I hope you're planning to eat well. But they'll also have a meal over there tonight at 5:30. They will have four churches that will come together, Mount Pleasant, Mountain Springs, Macedonia, and Sandy Ridge. And so we'll be gathering over there at 5:30 if you'd like to come eat. If not, the worship service starts at 7 o'clock there at Sandy Ridge. I hope you'll make plans to be there. We'll try to worship in a community effort, and I think it's a wonderful thing for churches to join together and to be able to worship and get to see other people that we don't normally see on a day-to-day basis or a Sunday-to-Sunday basis. So I hope you'll make plans to be there. That means also no service tonight. Our youth or children, they will not be practicing. And also this Wednesday night, since it's the day before Thanksgiving, we will not have our regular Wednesday night service either, but we'll come again together and worship again next Sunday morning. I also, there's one that's not mentioned in your bulletin today. I want to make mention of that. I know that I have been here since March of last year, and during that time, the Pastor Search Committee has been diligently, even prior to that, serving and working. I don't know how many resumes collectively they have looked at or how many videos they've watched of people preaching or men preaching. But I know it's quite a few, but I also know this, they have not found exactly the person they believe that God is directing here to Mountain Springs. So they mentioned it, that we as a church and we as not only members of this church, but if we're faithfully attending here, we want God's will to be done. We have a very special opportunity to be a great witness. I know there's other churches in our county that are larger churches, but God has blessed Mountain Springs in a way and just blessed not only the buildings that are here, facilities that are here. There's just a spirit here that God has greatly blessed in years past and still continues to bless. So we as a church need to have more of an intentional prayer. Praying not only for the pastor search committee, but praying wherever. I remember when our children were little, we brought them home from the hospital and placed that baby in the crib there, and we would pray for them to grow healthy and to be a strong Christian, but also praying for their spouse some 20 years in advance. We didn't know exactly who or when they would get married, but we knew that God had somebody in store for them. And so our goal here at Mountain Springs, we're going to be praying intentionally for the pastor. We're going to pray whoever he is that God is going to send the right man here to lead Mountain Springs Baptist Church. You know, the pastor is not the head of the church. I've had pastor search committees come to me and talk to me, and some churches are pastor-led and some churches are deacon-led. And so they always ask me, you know, in the churches that you're familiar with, who's the leader, who's the director in that church, who's the main person in that church? Are you pastor-led or deacon-led churches? And I always tell the people the same every time I'm asked that question. If it's not Christ-led, it's worthless. And so we want God's will to do and God's man to be here. I have a whole lot of love for this church and the people that are in this church, and I better hurry because several people told me I need to be through by 12 today. There's food in the fellowship hall. But we want to spend just a moment this time. Every time we get together, we're going to pray, and somebody help me remind myself until I get into the habit of it, of praying intentionally for the pastor search committee, and for us as a church. So let's go to the Lord right now. We'll have that time. Well, before I do that, I'll have that and we'll get our music come up here. But I want to recognize a couple of people. We have two people over here who's never been here before. We have Mr. and Ms. Casey Aldridge, is that right? I tried to think of her last name. Technically, I guess they've been here, but they haven't been that. So they got married last Sunday, and so they're here today. And I will be talking to all of those at the wedding that danced. I have video of that, and we'll be having an altar call at the end. I'm just kidding. Thankfully, I think it was all women up there. It was our Wild Women of Mountain Springs that were dancing. So maybe they'll fill up the altar. You know, every church ought to have their women in the right place in God's house. So we'll expect to have a good filled altar call today. But anyway, we're glad to have y'all back with us. Also, Joan and Al Adams have got their son. Is it Chris? Amanda? Amber and Logan. Is that correct? All right. Logan, how old are you? You're five? Okay. So it's good to have both, all three of you today visiting with us. I don't see any other visitors here today, so we'll go ahead and let's have a prayer. Let's stand together. We're praying for not only for God's will to be done, but for the pastor and the pastor search committee. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for this day that you've created that we can come into your house and worship you. And Lord, it's just a wonderful day to be able to come and join together with our family and friends here at Mountain Springs to be able to fellowship together and worship you together. But Lord, we also realize too that there is a very important need. And that is a need. As the flock is without a full-time pastor, Lord, we need that man that you've prepared. And we also pray for him wherever he may be, whether it's North Carolina or wherever he may be, Lord, we don't know, but you do. Even 20 years, 30 years, 40 years in advance is nothing compared to what you have in store. And you know exactly there's nothing too big for you to do. So right now we just pray for the church. We pray for the pastor, whoever he may be. We pray for this committee as they all come together in one accord to be able to bring about your glory in this community. We'll give you the praise and glory for it all. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen.
Hymn number 461, I love to tell the story. if you will, turn and smile at your neighbor before we, while she plays through a part of a verse. But when we sing, it'll be all three verses, hymn number 461.
Thank you, dear God, most kind and loving and heavenly Father. When you're up against a struggle that shatters all your dreams, and your hopes have been cruelly crushed by Satan's manifested schemes, and you feel the urge within you to submit to earthly fear, don't let the faith you're standing in seem to disappear. Praise the Lord. Remember that Satan is a liar, and he wants to make us think that we are paupers, when he knows himself that we're children of the King. So lift up the mighty shield of faith, for the battle must be won. We know that Jesus Christ is risen.
Into the special. I was so carried away, I was just going to go right into the special, forget about the second congregation. And I told Miss Pam, I don't know if y'all realize it, a few weeks ago we missed the congregational, and she told me. So I said, Pam, you called my hand on it. So Tony, what'd she do? She called my hand. She said, congregational. So anyway, let's do another congregational. How about it? Hymn number 335, Standing on the Promises. Sometimes, I don't know, I get carried away.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises sing. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior, standing, standing. promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fall, when the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises, I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Thanksgiving time, you know, you start thinking about all God's done for you in your life. And, you know, if Jesus did nothing more than die for us, you know, he's already given us everything. He's actually gave us more than we ever deserved. And, but he didn't just come and save us from hell. He came and he gave us his Spirit that dwells inside of us, and he's with us from day to day. And as I thought about Lord, I need you. Think about if you had to live your day without the Holy Spirit inside you, you know, guiding you when you needed guidance, convicting you when you needed convicting, and just all the encouragement that comes just from reading his word and knowing who he is. So I want you to think about your relationship with God and what he means to you. Not just that he saved you from hell, which is great and more than we ever deserve, but the fact that he lives and works in you daily. Think about that, and think about how much you need the Spirit inside you.
Lord, I need you. Oh, my one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Start from down here. It's going to wait for Andrew to get back out here. I tell you, he did a great job. I went to school with Randy Travis. I thought that was better than anything Randy ever did. I did. I really went to school with Randy. It was a tray wig back then. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Corinthians. Actually, I guess there's two of them. Turn to 2 Corinthians. I'm trying to remember which one it was. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. We'll get to the scripture text in just a few minutes. I know I've shared with you several times about, or at least once, about the discovery of America, but I think it's important for us to remember that. Our children that learn in school today get a different idea or a different version of the pilgrims and how America began the first functioning colonies here in North America. So I think it's important that we just remind ourselves history tells a completely different story. There was a group of Puritans that were meeting and living in England in 1607, and at that time they wanted to have the freedom to be able to worship. Now, I know that our Constitution, the very First Amendment, there's so many directions I could tell you today. I am so disappointed in our Congress, at least the Senate, this past week of the United States, of their vote for the, actually they call it, I'm not even sure what the name of their bill is, but it's that they don't care for marriage amendment is what I call it. They just threw marriage out the window. Actually, I'm not sure the government ought to be in marriage business anyway. It's God ordained, and God is the one that brings the couple together. So the government ought to just keep their nose out of it and everything else. Andrew, you weren't here, but I told him that I went to school with Randy Travis, and you did a whole lot better job than he ever did. So I thank you for that. That was beautiful. But I am so disappointed in the direction America is going, at least from their moral issues. And I believe that as we are looking at biblical end times, we're seeing some of those events take place. But in 1607, even in England, there was a battle with the government at how you were going to worship. they wanted, in fact, one ruler, they said, oh, you got to worship through the Roman Catholic, and oh, we got to worship through the Anglican Church. But this Puritans, they said, we want to worship ourselves, or at least worship the way we want to. And so they left in 1607, went to Holland for a few years, and still they received persecution in Holland. But they were all Englishmen, so they came back to England, and at that time the government was giving them rights, or giving people rights to set up colonies in the United States, or I should say in the new continent, America. And so they applied, and they received a grant from the King of England that they could come to Virginia and be able to worship, or at least set up a colony there. They would not have any restrictions on what and how they were to worship God. And so that was what made them excited about coming. This nation was founded, at least from the English side, or at least from the those that came over. They came over specifically because they wanted freedom of religion, be able to worship God the way God intended them, be able to read the Bible that the way they felt like it needed to be read and the way they wanted to interpret that. And so they came here in 1620. There was 102 of the colonists that came over. During that first winter, they actually left in September and landed sometime in early November. But it was a cold winter. They did not end up in Virginia, even though their rights said that they had the colonization rights for England. They ended up in what we now call Massachusetts, there at Plymouth Rock. And because of that, they didn't have any jurisdiction or any law-abiding rulership among themselves. So they signed what is called the Mayflower Compact. The Mayflower Compact was their decision that they wanted to say, this is how we want rule. And they elected certain officers to be in charge and certain people to have certain responsibilities. But one of the very important things about how that Mayflower Compact ended, I don't know if you can read it up there, it says, in the name of God, amen, having undertaken for the glory of God and the advancement of the Christian faith. And so that was why they came to America to begin with. They wanted to be able to worship Jesus Christ in the way they wanted to. And so that first winter out of 102, they lost half. 50-something died. The next spring, they were able to bury their dead because the ground was so cold they couldn't even dig the graves. They buried those. So now about 50 men, the ship set sail back to England, leaving those 50 Americans there, 50 colonists there that wanted to have freedom. They had a difficult time. They were going to starve if they didn't plant food because they had to eat. They had enough provisions to last them through the summer, but they would not make it through the next winter. And I've told you this before, but it's an amazing story. The providence of God, how He had planned way ahead of anything that the pilgrims were expecting to encounter. Out from the land, or out from the jungles, out from the forest of New England, walked a Native American. He spoke to them in English. They were amazed. We now know Squanto had been captured some years before, had been taken back to England. There in England, he learned English, but he also learned something else. He learned about Jesus Christ, and he became a Christian. And so now when the ship was there in the harbor, Squanto met those men that came ashore. There were 50 men and women, and he taught them how to grow the crops, something called corn or maize at that time, and they were completely amazed. I'm dropping everything. Let me pick it up. They were completely amazed at how much production they had. And so I'm not sure if it was 1621, the next fall, or a year or so after. There was so much abundance at that time that the pilgrims came together and wanted to thank not only the Native Americans there, but they wanted to thank God. And so they invited them to a 3-day feast I know you say, well, we only have one day for Thanksgiving. Actually, you got Friday and Saturday, or Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. You get 3 days anyway. But they had a three-day feast. They did serve venison. They did serve turkeys. They did serve other appetizing foods, and some that the Indians brought also. But they celebrated by sharing that Jesus Christ was the reason they had come, and they wanted to give their thanks to him. You know, even though America had some very difficult times, you can look back at the instances that happened and always see the hand of God was in everything. This nation would not have existed had it not been for God's providential hand upon it. And instance after instance, from the Revolutionary War to even the Civil War and all the events that took place in World War I and World War II. In fact, some of you may have served in some of those, maybe not necessarily World War II, but at least the Korean conflict, Korean War, or Vietnam. But we see that God's hand, even though America has never been perfect, God's hand has been involved in the establishment of this nation and the godly people that are here. Now, the reason I say that is, if God can prepare a Native American to learn English, to be a Christian, to show Americans or people, pilgrims, to come over here how to grow food, in all of the places they could have landed, if they had landed in Virginia, they would not have found that same person. But God knew exactly where they would be. The same idea is that God has a provision for you. He has made something for you, and you may not recognize it. You may not even acknowledge it. But God has directed your path, even to the point of being here this morning, so that you might be able to praise his name. But I believe that when we get to heaven, for those of you that make it to heaven, and those people that don't, you're going to find out some shocking things. But for those that do, we're going to realize, I believe that God's going to replay our lives in our own hearts and minds and reveal to us many of the things that occurred in our life that we never even acknowledged, that God had a miraculous hand in it. And when we see that, we're just going to sit back. Well, I never knew that. I never understood that. As that the group just sang, as we've sung some of the congregational hymns, God's miracles are alive in our life, even though we may not recognize them. And one of the first things, as Seth said, we've got to be thankful for his salvation. We did not deserve the salvation of Jesus Christ. The Bible says, and I know some of you think, well, I'm not that bad of a person. But the Bible describes us in comparison, let's say. If you compared your life to me, you may not be too bad a person. But if you came into the presence of God, his holiness, his purity would be so great that you would recognize it. And the Bible says, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. When the very first time you and I come into his presence face to face and we hear his name mentioned, we're going to fall flat on our face. Just as Isaiah did in the Old Testament. He says, I'm undone, God. I have unclean lips. I'm not worthy to be in your presence. And we're going to be surprised at the glory of God. As we talked about the other night, the majesty of God, his great, his glory filled all of creation. And we're going to see that one day. Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul is describing an undescribable gift. If you can describe something that is undescribable, Paul does the best he can. Words are not enough for us to describe the greatness of God. We can only use human concepts and human words. But the understanding of who God is way beyond that. And I've used the illustration before. You know, I read my newspaper. I used to when I had a cat a long time ago. And that cat would sit there and watch me read my newspaper. That cat had no clue what I was doing with reading that newspaper. The majesty of God is so great that we will not even be able to understand it. Even when His glory is visible, it will be beyond describable words to us. I'm going to ask you, if you will, to stand as we honor the reading of God's word. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, starting in verse 6. But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully will reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. And God, who is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. I've never been there, but I've been close a couple of times. If you've ever been, we were whitewater rafting in the New River in Virginia one time. And we went down a rapids, but actually I had gotten out of the raft at the warm water there, and there was a fall that was called the elevator. And the elevator is such that when you get in it, it takes you straight down. It sucks you down into the bottom. And then it starts pushing you back up, and you can see the surface of the light up above the surface of the water, but just before you reach that, it sucks you right back down. They had told us if you ball up in a little tiny ball, it will shoot you out at the top. But if you struggle and fight, it won't. So after the second time, I did that. I balled up and I came shooting out. And that first gasp of air, boy, it was something exciting to know, because I was struggling at that time to get air. And I think about this, that it says here in verse 8, always having all sufficiency of all things, may abound to every good. God gives us the very air that we breathe. And how wonderful it is. Now, most of us don't think about that every day. But when you have a lack of oxygen, it begins to become a primary focus of you. Look only at verse 9. Here's a quote from actually Psalms 112. He says, as it is written, he hath dispersed abroad. He hath given to the poor, his righteousness remaineth forever. Now he that ministereth seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food and multiply your seed sown. Now that's an interesting little statement. You know, we thank God for the farmers that farm, but they have to have the seed. And the seed came from God. In the very beginning, he created creation. He created the plants and the trees and everything with seeds so that they would multiply. And he says that we thank God for the one that brings the food and the bread, for the ones that's prepared it. We're thankful for each of those. I know that, Janice and Harold and Lori, at least the three, they were here at 5 o'clock this morning putting in the turkeys to cook. They're not out here. They're probably back there asleep, but they're probably in the kitchen working hard. But we're thankful for them for doing that. But God provided the turkeys. He made the first ones. So it all, ultimately, everything we have goes back to God. Look at verse 11. Being enriched in everything to all bountifulness, which causes through us thanksgiving to God, for the administration of his service, not only supplieth the want of the saints, he gives us sometimes what we want, but is abundant also with many thanksgivings. He gives us many other things that we never even think about. You know, if you've got somebody sick or you're hungry or whatever, you're going to pray for those things. But he gives, most of us get stuff every single day that we pass up and never thank God for. But remember, every little thing comes from God. Verse 13. Whiles by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your possessed subjection unto the gospel of Christ, and for your liberal distribution unto them. Paul is saying, thank you for all the things that you have sent to the church at Corinth, had sent to where he was, I believe in Ephesus. And by their prayer for you, which long after you for the exceeding grace of God in you. I want us all to read the next verse together. It says in verse 15, read together out loud. Thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these amazing words and so clear words that Paul gives to us, explaining that we may thank other people for the things they do, but ultimately it all goes back to you. You're the provider of everything. You're the provider of the air we breathe, the clothes that we wear, the food that we eat, even the very thoughts that we have in our mind. You have given us, each and every one, the ability to think by giving us a brain or a mind where we can use to reason and comprehend. But Father, there is an undescribable or indescribable gift. And that indescribable gift is, as was said earlier, Jesus Christ himself. He's the only one that could not only have given us eternal life, but he also promised us abundant life here on this earth. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all you've done for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. I know sometimes at Thanksgiving we go around the table and we sometimes say, I'm thankful for this or I'm thankful for that. And we should do that. Those are important things. We should, especially if, all the time. Sometimes we don't always do it. We need to thank that cook that we have. For us husbands, we need to thank our spouses there for the food that they've prepared for us. But remember the food they've given to us. You know, we may have worked a little bit to acquire the money to buy the food. They may have too. Somebody down the road had to kill the cow or hog or whatever it was. Somebody had to grow the seeds or grow the wheat to make the bread that we're eating. Somebody may have actually had to churn the butter to give us butter or margarine or whatever we eat to make the food taste a little better. All of the things that have gone into the preparation of a meal. But if you trace it back, it ultimately leads back to one source. And that source, of course, is God himself. God says it like this. Look at verse 10. Now he that ministereth seed to the sower, both minister bread for your food. He's the one, the seed itself, but he not only gives us the food, but he also gives us more seed that we can plant. He multiplies your seed sown, increase the fruits of your righteousness. God is the source of all of our blessings. If we don't understand that, then we have greatly misplaced our thoughts. Now, I know a lot of people think about football on Thanksgiving Day. Some people get out the newspaper and start going through the ads about the Black Friday sales. I don't know if they start Thursday night or Friday morning. Sometimes they start at 2 or 3 o'clock, and sometimes they go back Thursday night. But I think that every one of us as a family ought to realize the blessings actually stem from God himself. God is the supplier of all of our needs. And once we come to that realization, then every moment of every day ought to be something that we're thinking about and giving God the praise. Whether it's the air that we breathe, whether it's that honey bun that we eat, whether it's that good hot pizza that we wolf down because we're so hungry, or if you're hot and sweaty and you want a cool drink and you turn that bottle of water up, we ought to thank God because God has given us all of that. But ultimately, the greatest gift of all is that he's promised not only here on this earth that he will be with us, but he's promised us that we can have eternal life through him. That's something that we ought to always be thankful about. I'm so thankful that God has given us the opportunity to be saved. I'm so thankful that he did save me many, many years ago. I'm thankful that he sent me here 35 years ago in November of 1987 to be the youth pastor here at Mountain Springs. I'm so thankful for the friendships that I have encountered over the last 35 years. I'm so thankful that God has given me the opportunity to finish up my ministry here at Mountain Springs. I'm so thankful for the many faces that were here 35 years ago. You may look a little 35 years different than you did back then, but the faces are still the same. The Spirit of God and the hearts are still the same. And I'm so thankful that God has given us a place that we can come and worship him. You know, a lot of people are not really thankful for their church. I know sometimes people are, but there's many people that look at church as a drudgery. They look at church as, well, I got to go to church. I feel guilty if I don't go to church. I've talked to a lot of people. How long has it been since you've been in church? Well, it's been a long time. I know I need to get back in church. They don't really know that. They're just saying that. Because if they really had realized just what God had done for them each and every day of their life, they would want to be able to come. Now, church itself, the building itself, it's important, but it's not what church really is. When you turn around from side to side and look behind you and you see all the people that's here, the Bible tells us that this is what the church is. In fact, as the description that's given to us in the Bible, the church is actually our spiritual family. And we must recognize that God has given us a spiritual family. Most people want to go back home at Thanksgiving. Most people want to go back home at Christmas or some other holiday time where they can bring back the memories when they were a child and remember the joy that they had. And they want their children to experience that also. But you and I, as Christians, this church or the fellowship of believers that are with us, this is the family that God has given to us as spiritual believers. We are not united through blood. Now, some of you may be kin through blood, but we are all united together as one by the Spirit of God that flows through every single heart and every single one that's born again. Now, if you're not born again, you can fellowship. You can have that closeness with other people. But unless you have really been born again and put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you will never fully understand the closeness that's needed for other church people or other Christians and the need to be around them. Now, I know this is a small child. As a small child, they need their parents. They get a little frightened and they run and hide behind their mother's coattails or behind her dress or behind her legs or whatever. They see daddy off and they run to daddy and they hold their hands up and they cry out, daddy. They want that safety. They want that security. They want the assurance. This one person or these two people that have protected them all of their life, they want to feel that closeness. Really, God's provisions are like that. And you and I should enjoy being in the presence of God just as that little child runs to their father for safety and security and feel that hug of that man as he puts his arms around them and hugs them. We ought to come to God realizing that he has given to us that great example of parents, but he wants to demonstrate it in the spiritual way. And we can do that by coming to church and being a part of him. There's something else that we demonstrate our love and our thanks for him. You know, a lot of times we thank people. We get a gift. We write a little note. Casey, Jane, if you hadn't done that lately, you're probably going to end up having to write some notes. You really want to learn something about your husband? Get Casey to write all the thank you notes and you will find out. But writing those thank you notes, you take one and you'll say, thank you so much for the silver set, or thank you so much for the blanket or whatever. You seal it in an envelope and it's soon forgotten. But you and I have been given greater gifts than we could ever receive. And God does not want us just to say, thank you, God, for this. And even when we pray, we say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for this food that we're about to eat. May it be a strength to our bodies, or whatever phrase we're using. And we say, thank you, Lord. But that's not what God really wants us to show our thanksgiving with. Saying the words is important. But we read how we truly show our thanksgiving to God. Look at verse 6 and 7. He says, but this I say to he that soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Now listen to this. Every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Now I know if you read much of what's going on in many of the denominations or many of the Christian areas, evangelical Christian areas today, you will find that there is a big discussion about tithing. The Old Testament mentions tithing. The word tithing does mention or mean 10%. But you will not find, now listen carefully, you will not find the word tithing mentioned in the New Testament. You say, well, Pastor, does that mean we don't have to tithe? No, because here's what it says. And here is the directive that you have been given by God. But I say unto you, verse 6, but I say unto you, he who sows sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he that soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. In fact, 10%. That's an Old Testament. The Bible tells us in the New Testament that we're to give of the bounty that God has given to us. That we're to share even more than 10% God has greatly blessed us. And so therefore we ought to be giving to those that are in need. Those that we want to demonstrate. I know those little shoe boxes that we delivered this past week, or that Sandra or someone delivered. We prayed over them just a couple of weeks ago. And those will be sent around the world, wherever they may go. We can hear about stories about how the kids receive them. But every single day, God has blessed us in a way that we ought to be cheerfully giving to others. Boy, it got quiet in here all of a sudden. Some of us want to thank God by using the verbal words of saying thank you. But then when we're expected to give, and you say, well, Pastor, how much should I give? I don't know. Just give whatever God leads you to give. He also says this. If you give and you give it grudgingly, you miss the point. In fact, I will say this. If you hate to give money to God or give it to the church, don't give. It doesn't do God any good. He doesn't need the money. And you don't need to give grudgingly. But you need to give it with a cheerful heart, that you have a child that you have saved up. If you have a difficult time when you're first married and you've got that child and you want to buy them that special gift, and you save your money every week, and then you go down and buy that special gift for maybe your wife or maybe your child or something, and on Christmas morning when that gift is given to them, and you just see the smile come across the face, and they run up and they jump and they grab a hold of you and hug you and thank you. That's the way we ought to give to God, cheerfully. Like God's going to, it's not that he's going to grab us and hold on to us, but we ought to give like we're grabbing on to him and thanking him for the blessings that he has given to us. He said, God loveth a cheerful giver. Our thankfulness ought to be demonstrated to others. That's actually the proof. Now, I know that may sound a little crazy. You do not give to others to prove that you are saved. You don't give to the church to prove that you are saved. You are saved by grace through faith, and that's the only way. No amount of money can purchase away into heaven. Nor can any, or should, no amount of money should be able to purchase the positions in a church. But I will say this, if you truly love God, you want to give as much as you can to God and to the work of His kingdom, because you want to be able to share with other people the blessings. That's how we demonstrate to God. It's not necessarily just giving to others that and seeing the smile on their face, but we're demonstrating God's love for them. Look at verse 13. Whilst by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your possessed subjection unto the gospel of Christ. See, this church at Corinth, Paul is writing to, he's in Ephesus, and there was a need that was there, and the church at Corinth took up an offering and liberally sent them a lot of money that would be able to help them out of their dire situations there. And they did not do it out of wanting to receive the thanks from the other people, but they did it to demonstrate the glory of God. You see, when you give, you're demonstrating the glory of God. Should we say thank you at Thanksgiving? Yes, of course. But we need to demonstrate it every single day of our life, just what God has done to us. It brings glory to God. Did you know that when you do, Jesus said it like this, whatsoever you have done it unto the least of these my brethren, what's the rest of that? You have done it unto me. You see, when we do it to others, when we give to others, when we share with others, we are actually demonstrating the glory of God to them. Now, I know some people give. Some people that are not Christians, they may give. I'm always interested in seeing some report of some billionaire giving $1 million to some organization or some group. And the people just laud them over and say, oh, you've given $1 million. If they're a billionaire, that's only 1/1000th of what they have. That's a small amount. In fact, Jesus saw the widow as she came through the temple treasury area. There was a guy that preceded her. He blew the trumpets. Everybody cleared the path. This wealthy man walked in. He may have had a sack full of gold or silver, and he drops it in the treasury. And everybody is excited because, wow, did you see all of that? But then the crowd comes back together, and the rich man goes on, and he receives his pat on the back from those that are around him. But in walks a little lady that no one notices. No one sees her, but Jesus does. And he gets the attention of his disciples, and you see her. And they see her walk over, and she drops two of the cheapest little coins in, two little widow mites. And Jesus makes that famous statement that ought to be the same. I know it's important for us to understand it, but it ought to touch our hearts. Jesus says, she gave more than he did. And the disciples, not hardly, Lord, can't you count? I mean, he gave a whole bunch of silver and gold, and she just had two little copper coins that were there, almost worthless. And Jesus makes that famous statement. She gave all that she had. I know that I don't usually preach sermons on giving, but I also want to realize, I want you to realize. Now, I'm not one of those that a television evangelist or whatever says, you need to send your seed money in. Send me $1,000 and I'll send you 1,000 blessings and you'll be blessed by God. Men are great. I'm not that type of person. I'm not telling you to give money. I will tell you this. Mountain Springs, and I want you to know, I'm not saying this because I'm just the interim pastor. I've said it to other churches too. Mountain Springs and God, they do not need your money. Amen. Thank you. Appreciate it. We need to give because it demonstrates how much we love God. Now, I'm not talking about just giving money to the church so the church can build more buildings. There's a lot of churches out there that's what they take their money. We're going to build more buildings. No. We need to give to those that are hurting, those that are around. We give it to the church. If you give your money through, and I'm not knocking any of these organizations, I'm knocking some of them. I saw where, I believe it was, who is Jeff Bezos? Is that Amazon? Jeff Bezos? He gave so much money. He gave it to Planned Parenthood. Their main goal is to kill babies. They use it for a few other things. They use like 20% for, they call it women's health. But 80% of that money is funded to the abortion clinics and causes more abortions, the killing of babies. So when he gives his millions, that's not what we're talking about. But when we give through the church, he got his reward. But when we give through the church, Christ gets the glory. The Samaritan's purse, the money that was given to get those shoeboxes, they will be used in the mission field to not only reach children, but to reach children's families. Food will be provided. Health care will be provided. When times of disaster come, the Baptist men of North Carolina, some of the first ones on the mission field. All of those are showing not just how good Baptist men are, but is showing the greatness of God. That last verse again, it says, thanks be to God for this unspeakable gift. What is that unspeakable gift? It's everything. Everything that you have is the unspeakable gift from God. If it was not for that, you would have nothing. As Job said when he came into the world, he said, I came into the world naked, and I will leave this world naked. You haven't produced anything. You haven't made anything on your own. If you can't give the glory to God, then you have deceived yourself. Because you might have a big business. You might have plenty of money. And you might think, I have earned this myself. I've worked hard for this. But who gave us the strength to work? Who gave us the mind to be able to think? All of these things are just simple little areas. It all goes back to God. He is the provider of every indescribable gift that you will ever have, and we need to give to God. The first way we give to God is he says, I want you. Says there, and we've part of that is a memorization verse there in Romans chapter 12. Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present yourselves as a what? Living sacrifice. He doesn't want your money. He wants you. He wants you. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is the day you ought to say, I come realizing that I am not I'm not able to offer God anything. In fact, you can't give to God. It's already His anyway. We may think we can give to God. We may think we can give to other people, but it all belongs to Him. Everything is His. We only get a chance to use it while we're here on this earth. And God's going to find out how we're using it by how we give to Him and give our thanks. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this indescribable gift that you have given to us. And Lord, I pray today that each one of us would reckon in our own heart and realize that we're not talking about money. We're talking about giving all that we have. We're talking about giving ourselves to you. Father, that's what you require. We say, well, I'll give $1 million to the church. God doesn't want that. He wants you. He wants each and every person to accept Him as Lord of their life and to be able to spend eternity in His presence. That's an indescribable gift. And all of us have been blessed with that opportunity, whether we have received it or not. Father, help us today to make that decision for you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. Amen. What hymn number, Brother Rick? He's looking. If God... Who's got a bulletin? 347. 347. 347. I should have looked at it. Let's stand together. Hymn number 347. If God is speaking to you, we invite you to come as God leads. Don't say, "Oh, Pastor, I want to give Sunday mornings to the Lord." Forget it. He doesn't want that. He's got all the Sunday mornings since eternity started. He wants you. "Pastor, I'd like to give $1,000 or $10,000. He doesn't want it. He wants you. If you are ready to give yourself, that's what he wants, as we sing.
To Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him, his presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender. Jesus, I surrender, make me Savior wholly thine. Let me feel thy Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender,
everybody knows Ann, so she was here when I was here many years ago, and so she's moved, but she comes today wishing to reunite to Mountain Springs Baptist Church. I promised a letter from Solid Rock, and Mesquite back there is just bawling her eyes out, I think. But we're excited about this, and so you be much in prayer for Ann. Do I hear a motion that we receive her? We got two or three all over the place. All right, here's the way I do it. If you want to receive her as a part of your fellowship here, then signify by saying amen, but also raising your hand. I like to see and hear. Amen. So, Ann, we welcome you back, and we're so excited about that. So you be much in prayer for her and the family, too. You have anything you want to say?
Not really. The church has shown me a lot of love.
Well, God bless you, Ann. God bless you. All right, well, I'm going to get you to stand back at the door and let everybody speak to you. And Skeet, we'll let you stand there too. Oh, most people are going that way? Okay.
I'll just see them out
there. All right, you'll see them. Okay, you can speak to her out there. So I forgot about that. We're not going out. In fact, go back in there and lock that door. We're not letting anybody go out. Chris, Amber, is that right? Did I get it right that time? And Logan, we're glad to have you with us. And we'll be sure to speak. And I know we've got a lot of our regular folks here, but if we could let our guest here go first today and somewhere close to the front of the line, maybe not right at the very beginning, but somewhere close, and then all of our seniors, and then all of the good-looking people next, and then all of the kids. No, I'm just kidding, but we'll let our seniors go right after our guests are here today, and we're so excited about this. We did vote, didn't we? Raised hand. Okay, I want to make sure I didn't miss something. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. And we're going to go ahead and have the blessing here so that those that get over there before I get over there, we'll go ahead and let you get started eating. But be sure to thank Harold and Janice and Lori for and the others that have prepared. There's a lot of food that's out there, but we want to thank them too. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come with thanksgiving in our heart, a fellowship meal of the church that we're able to fellowship together. Father, we're so thankful that Ann comes today, and just as she said, that the church has shown a lot of love. Father, this is a loving church, and they've shown me, Annette and I, a whole lot of love, And we're thankful for that. But most of all, Father, we're thankful for your love that what you showed for us at Calvary. And because of that, we do have an indescribable gift that has been given to us, and we want to thank you. Also, thank you for the food that's been prepared and those that have prepared it. But also, Father, we remember too, ultimately, it all goes back to your provisions for us, and we're amazed at that. Thank you again for all those that worked yesterday out on the yards of the ground and working for the prayer garden and the playground. Father, we'll give you the glory for it all. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Everybody heads that direction.